que te conocí. Tengo una huella perdida entre tu sombra y la mía que no me deja mentir. Soy una moneda en la fuente, tú mi deseo pendiente, mis ganas de revivir. Tengo una mañana constante y una acuarela esperando verte pintado de azul. Tengo tu amor y tu suerte y un caminito empinado. Tengo el mar del otro lado, tú eres mi norte y mi sur. Hoy voy a verte de nuevo y vos envolverme en tu ropa. Susurrame en tu silencio cuando me veas llegar. Hoy voy a verte de nuevo y vos alegar tu tristeza. Y vamos a hacer una fiesta para que este amor crezca más. Hoy voy a verte de nuevo y vos envolverme en tu ropa. Susurrame en tu silencio cuando me veas llegar. Hoy voy a verte de nuevo. Hoy voy a alegrar tu tristeza. Y vamos a hacer una fiesta para que este amor crezca más.
Vámonos, Enrique.
Tengo una frase colgada entre mi boca y mi almohada que me desnuda de ti. Tengo una plaza y un pueblo que me acompañan de noche cuando no estás junto a mí. Tengo una mañana constante y una acuarela esperando verte pintado de azul. Tengo tu amor y tu suerte y un caminito empinado. Y tengo el mar del otro lado, tú eres mi norte y mi sur. Hoy voy a verte de nuevo y voy a envolverme en tu ropa. Susurrame en tu silencio cuando me veas llegar. Hoy voy a verte de nuevo y voy a alegrar tu tristeza. Y vamos a hacer una fiesta para que tu amor crezca más. Hoy voy a verte de nuevo, voy a envolverme en tu ropa. Susurrame en tu silencio cuando me veas llegar. Hoy voy a verte de nuevo, voy a alegrar tu tristeza y vamos a hacer una fiesta.
Hello, good morning, good afternoon. Welcome to the International Plant Breeding Seminar Series here from NC State in North Carolina. Today, it's our pleasure to have with us Dr. Susana Lewis, Milla Lewis, with a seminar in the turfgrass breeding, finding commercial niches for a new public program. Susana got her PhD from here from NC, her master's from NC State in tobacco breeding, and her PhD from NC State, also in the Pinot Breeder. He has been with us since in our research group since 2004 as a senior researcher, then as an assistant professor, and now as an associate professor. Susana, thank you so much. Also, it's the first time that we have a special request for music for this seminar, a beautiful song from a Peruvian author and almost an anthem for us in Latin America. Thank you so much, and thank you for providing a lot of the photos that celebrate your program, Susana. If you want, I'm gonna stop sharing if you wanna start now.
Thanks, Carlos. Good morning, everybody. I have to say that I enjoy the slide, the video a lot, Carlos. Thank you. It's kind of like a little history of the breeding program, and it was nice to see some of those pictures.
Yeah, I imagine.
So good morning, everybody. Good afternoon. Carlos, thanks a lot for the introduction. I have to say that I usually get to talk about turfgrass breeding to other members of the turfgrass community, and it's always exciting to be able to talk about the program to other breeders. When Carlos invited me, he mentioned that it would be interesting to give a little bit of the perspective of what starting a new breeding program is, and kind of like the process that we went through and some of the progress that we have made. So, you know, I know that I'm talking to a very diverse audience in terms of crops, so I figured that at first I would talk a little bit about turfgrass. I'll take too long. But I know that probably some of you are not as familiar with turfgrass and think, you know, why turfgrass? This is a minor crop. But I have to remind you that, you know, in the US, it actually is a very huge industry. This is an old graph, and I'm not sure how, you know, exactly accurate it is, but it is a fact that turfgrass in terms of acreage covers a lot of the US and is a very important crop. If we think about turf, usually, you know, like when we're talking to an international audience or just general public and you talk about turfgrass, most people tend to think, you know, okay, athletics, right? Most people tell you, okay, you work with golf courses or athletic fields. And that's true, that that's a very important sector of the industry that generates a lot of money and a lot of jobs. But there's also all these other sectors that we tend to think a little bit less about. This, for example, is a representation of the turfgrass industry in North Carolina in terms of acreage and in terms of, you know, like units in a way. And, you know, golf courses, there's a few. Of course, there's a lot of inputs that go into the maintenance of those courses. There is a lot of sod farms that, you know, produce the grasses that are going to go in across the state. And then homeowners are usually a sector that we don't think as much, right? And there's not a lot of input that goes into those areas. And the areas generally are small, but if you take, you know, into consideration like all across the state, how many homeowners there are and how many lawns there are is a huge sector of the industry. And then of course, there's the commercial side of things, right? Like landscapes, church lawns, cemeteries, even airports actually maintain turf grasses. And then the one that we don't think about much, but is actually pretty huge, is roadsides. The Department of Transportation maintains acres and acres and acres of roadsides of grasses in roadsides, medias, shoulders, exit ramps, those sorts of areas. So altogether, the turfgrass industry in North Carolina alone has an economic input of about $5 billion annually. This is, you know, from sales of grasses to jobs to inputs that goes in those grasses. So it's extremely important. If we think about turfgrass in the US in general, we tend to divide in north and south in a way. Cool season grasses are grown in the northern half of the US, and then warm season grasses, tropical grasses are grown in the south. And then there's this area in between that we call the transition zone or the transition climatic zone, where both of these types of grasses can be grown. So North Carolina, of course, is smack right in the transition zone. If we think about what these grasses are, in general, cool season grasses have C3 physiology, and these are some of the species that are traditionally grown in the US from this group. And then warm season grasses have C4 physiology, as I mentioned, these are tropical grasses, and these are some of the most important in that group grown in the US. So in general, cool season grasses have, you know, a spurt of growth in the spring. They go very well in the spring. they go a little, they kind of slow down during summer. If it's really hot and really dry, they might even go dormant a little bit. And then they have a second spur of growth in the fall. They generally stay green year round and they do not go dormant in winter. And then warm season grasses are kind of like exactly the opposite. They start growing in the spring. The biggest spur of growth occurs during the summer. They grow very actively. And then in fall, they start kind of slowing down and they go dormant in winter. And in our area, they actually, they're completely brown, basically winter long. So when we think about the transition zone and the grasses that are grown, basically, yes, we can grow all species, both groups, but we cannot grow either of them very well because usually cool season grasses will suffer summer stress, right? Like it's very common to see areas of dead grass, the heat, especially in our area, which is all tend to be humid, can attract a lot of diseases. So it's very common to see a sprinkler going on and on, right? And these grasses having to be watered quite often. And then the opposite is through warm season grasses. I mean, they're very happy during the summer, but then in winter, they can incur winter kill. There's these vast areas of grasses that can die in very cold winters. And then also one of the common things that we see in the transition zone is that it's kind of like disease paradise, right? The turf pathologist here at NC State, Jim Kearns, always says that he never gets bored and he'll never gonna be out of a job, because there's all these diseases to work with. And in terms of breeding, this is also of interest. So we started the program, and the program was established in 2009, and we basically start from zero. The existing germplasm when we started was very, very limited, just a few accessions. And we had all this area assigned to the breeding program in our main turfgrass unit, which is close to campus, but it was basically fallow and it had to be, we need to establish turf plots, we needed to establish underground irrigation. So in a way, it was really a white canvas on how, where to start, start really and truly from scratch. And of course, the first thing is, okay, what are gonna be our research priorities? What directions do we wanna take this program in? And that's considering species and traits to work on. So when trying to decide what were gonna be the species that we were gonna work on, the first question was obviously, okay, so where's the market, right? Like what are the species that are most commonly grown in North Carolina? And this back then, this was 10 years old. It was kind of oldish data, but that was the best data we had available. So we went with it. And if you look at, this kind of like distribution of what species are grown, about 50% of them were cool season grasses, right? So based on that, you might think, okay, so obviously for North Carolina, then we should be working on cool season grasses. But then to me, and another very important question was, okay, where are the niches that are still available for turfgrass breeding in the US? If we're gonna start, so far behind some of these like really well-established programs, we need to think about what are specific niches that could be filled. And if you look at the playing field in cool season grasses, there's a lot of programs out there. Rutgers, of course, they basically invented turfgrass breeding, right? I mean, one of the most famous turfgrass breeding programs and the strongest definitely in the US. There's other public programs in the North that work with cool season grasses. But then more importantly, there's a lot of private investment in turfgrass breeding of cool season grasses in the US. Slide is by no means all inclusive. I was trying just to represent some, but there's a lot of companies that are working on turfgrass breeding. And then if we look at the warm season playing field, the story is very different. It's mostly public breeding that is working on warm season grasses. There's a few companies working in seeded grasses. There's also a couple that are working on vegetative grasses. But you can see that, there's a lot more, a lot more room available for a new program to come in to work into warm season grasses. If you think about genomics, there were very few programs when I started that were working on warm season grass genomics. So, but then another very important question was, what are future trends, right? Like, okay, here's what we have in the industry right now. How is that industry gonna change in the future? And I remember somebody came and gave a seminar in the department around that time and showed this graph about basically a prediction, a number of days per year with peak temperatures above 90 degrees Fahrenheit. On the left, you have actual temperatures, the actual number of days from the 60s through the 80s. And then on the right, you have the graphs for the predicted number from 28, basically at the end of this century, right? And you can see a drastic change in that number, like basically 60s and 80s, you had about 30 days. And then the prediction for the end of the century is gonna be about 120 days. So based on these, the question is, should we really be working in cool season grasses for central North Carolina, right? Where that number is gonna be pretty high. So based on that, you know, thinking about, okay, what are the niches available? What are gonna be future trends? I decided that it made more sense for the program to concentrate more on warm season grasses. And we started working with Bermuda grass and Augustine grass, Soja grass and Centipede grass. And then we would still maintain a smaller you know, program working on cool season grasses, but we will work only until fescue, which was it is the cool season species that has one of the best heat and drought tolerances. So it made sense, you know, given on where the market is in North Carolina, yes, work in cool season, but let's try to focus on one that can survive better in our state. So based on that, we established these research priorities. We will work, you know, very important for the transition zone and cold tolerance for warm season grasses. Not only important for warm season grasses in the transition zone, but also in terms of niches geographically, because we were one of the few programs in the transition zone, we had that opportunity to, in a way, you know, like fill that niche. Shade tolerance is very important in North Carolina. There are a lot of home lawns and landscapes have pine trees present. So shade is very prevalent in the landscape, in home lawns. So that was an important trait to work on. And then of course, if we were gonna work with fescue, obviously increasing heat tolerance, drought tolerance was an important breeding objective. When talking about cold tolerance, it might seem, okay, with global warming, you're just thinking about how things are gonna get hotter, right? So do we really need cold tolerance? And one thing, when we're thinking about cold tolerance, one thing that has changed is these like fluctuations in temperatures, right? So it's not just what is the lowest temperatures that the grass can take, but the problem is these unpredictable winters that we're having where the temperature goes up and down. And whenever, you know, like you have a period of warmer temperatures, grasses deacclimate, they kind of start breaking dormancy. And then if you have a frost right after, that's when you have really bad winter kill. So cold tolerance remains very important, especially working on deacclimation. Disease resistance at the time started becoming more important. Before then, it was kind of like the philosophy of we can spray, so why would we worry about resistant cultivars? But around that time, that philosophy started to change and it started becoming, you know, like the environmental sustainability, the importance of that became more apparent. And a lot of people started working more seriously on breeding for disease resistance. And then decrease inputs. And that's something that has really, really increased in importance in the last 10 years. Not just focusing on having the perfect grass, but willing to, you know, give a little bit of that beauty in terms of making the grass more sustainable. And that goes into water usage. That's really important. But also, you know, like reducing reducing the use of fertilizer, reducing the use of chemicals in general. So that has become a really important focus of the breeding program. So in talking about projects that or areas that we have worked, that we have made some progress on, I'm kind of trying to focus on two different things. In St. Augustine grass, I'm gonna tell you a little bit of a story on where we started and what was kind of like the progress that we made through years. And then in Soja grass, I'm gonna talk about like specific areas that we worked on. So for St. Augustine grass, the species is Ctenotaphrum secundatum. It's a very desirable grass for the southern US because it's the most shade tolerant of warm season grasses. It performs well under a wide range of soil conditions. It is relatively low input and is definitely more drought tolerant than cool season grasses in general. In terms of taxonomy, there's seven different species in the genus Stenotaprum. Stenotaprum dimidatum is the most closely related, and it will hybridize with Sennelsen grass, although there is some barriers that need to be broken for that. The base chromosome number is 9, and there's a lot of diploid germplasm. There have been triploids and tetraploids reported, and then aneuploids had been reported, but the extent of aneuploidy in the species was not really fully evaluated. So now it's in grass breeding. When I started, so there were about 22 released cultivars in the market, but about only a third of those were still commercially available. A lot of others had just being lost, or they really weren't grown for multiple reasons. And then some of the most successful cultivars, as you can see here, were kind of old. Floratam, released in 1972, very old, still the standard for drought tolerance back then. Raleigh was the standard for freeze tolerance, and it was raised in the 80s. So, you know, there was the need for some newer cultivars. The main traits for improvement for our area, we wanted to improve a little bit leaf texture to make it a little bit finer texture. Freeze tolerance was very important for North Carolina in the center of the state, and all the grass will winter kill fairly easily. And then in terms of pest resistance, the southern chinch bug, which is a Blissus insularis, is one of the most damaging pests in St. Augustine grass. You can see a picture here, but basically you can have a whole lawn that is lost just due to chinch bugs. And then grape leaf spot is one of the most important fungal diseases. St. Augustine grass genetics in 2009, you know, where were we in like genetics, genomics in general? There was a limited understanding of speciation and ploidy levels within the genus. There was limited knowledge of genetic diversity, like in terms of the use of molecular markers to understand diversity. The markers available were AFLPs only. So we were like really behind in comparison to other crops and what were the tools being used. We had no linkage map for St. Augustine grass. And then of course, if we had no linkage maps, you know, like you couldn't even talk about QTL mapping. So with that in mind, we started a project in 2010 looking at using molecular markers to evaluate genetic diversity in the genus. And then we were also especially interested in looking at ploidy levels and understanding, you know, what were the ploidy levels available in public germplasm. So this research actually was one of the most important pieces of research that we did in the program. And it might seem very simple, right? Like you might think, okay, this was just another paper on genetic diversity. But this actually provided some key information for us to start the program. And there were two very, very important pieces. One was that we found out that a lot of the accessions, the public accessions that had been described as polyploids, they weren't actual triploids or tetraploids, but they were actually aneuploids. And what that meant was that using those for breeding was gonna be a lot more difficult and a lot more time consuming, right? Like our success rate was probably gonna be very low making those crosses. And it was gonna take a while to make any success with interspecific hybridization. And then the other key piece of information was finding out these specific pool of germplasm. These are African diploids, African Stenotaprum diploids, that were very different from everything else, from all the commercial cultivars. So we started looking at these germplasm pool, looking for, okay, what traits of interest might be present in these accessions. From there, we actually developed SSRs, which I know 10 years or 12 years later is almost funny to talk about SSRs, and my students kind of like, you know, raised their eyes at me when I mentioned these, but back then this was quite an accomplishment for St. Augustine grass. In a way, it was an orphan crop, and generating molecular tools was quite a hooray. This was part of Steve Mulkey's master's thesis, where he mined Illumina sequences for SSRs. And we were able to do, you know, like get a more detailed picture on the levels of genetic diversity in Stenotaprum germplasm. We also actually, you know, still use this SSR for fingerprinting of cultivars, which is very useful for detecting contamination in salt fields. So once we had, you know, found this interesting pool of germplasm, again, as I mentioned, we started looking at what might be traits of interest in this pool. So one of the main thing, diseases that we're interested in was gray spot. This is a major disease, as I mentioned. We knew from the literature that there were very high levels of resistance in polyploid germplasm. But again, we knew that making those clusters was going to take a while. So we started looking at screening germplasm for resistance to gray leaf spot. And we were especially interested in seeing if we could find resistance among diploid germplasm. And then seeing how resistance in the diploids would compare to that of polyploids. So this was a large study where we evaluated a lot of different accessions. This was done under controlled environmental conditions in growth in chambers where, you know, we would just spray conidial suspension and then look at disease evaluation daily over a week. And what we found was that, yes, you know, we confirmed there's very high levels of resistance among polyploids. You can have this is here an accession of turfgrass, and you can see that it's, you know, fairly clean, it's almost immune to the disease. Well, you have some cultivars where you can see that the lesions are all over the place. And then, you know, we were very excited because we actually identified, again, among the African diploids, some accessions that had very good levels of resistance. So the polyploids, turfgrass in particular, is highly resistant, but here you have this PI 410353 that has resistance that is comparable to that of the polyploids. So this was kind of like a hooray moment, right? Because now we know, okay, we can start breeding with these materials way more easily. So we had the resistant materials, and the next goal was, okay, let's try to understand better how is resistance inheritance, right? Like inherited. Let's try to identify some QTL that are controlling this resistance. So we crossed Raleigh, which is an old cultivar that was actually released by NC State in the 80s. And it has very good freeze tolerance. By the PI, developed a population of 158 hybrids, and then inoculated it in growth chambers as the germplasm strain. We measure disease progression for basically 3 to 7 days after inoculations, number of leaves with lesions, length of the lesions, and based on that data, we generated area under the disease progress curve and area under the leaf expansion curve. This is work that Steve Mulkey started as part of his master's thesis, and Dr. Xinguang Yu was able to complete. So we found two major regions in the PI on chromosome 5 and chromosome 2, where we had overlap of multiple QTL that explain, some of them were minor, but some of them were major QTL that explain a large amount of variation. And when Xinguang did annotation in these regions, we actually found some genes of interest that have been shown to have some effect on disease resistance. And we're actually continuing this work. Ashley Schoonmaker, who's a student of Amanda Holzkamp in the bioinformatics program, she's actually looking, doing RNA-seq work with the PI and Raleigh. She has collected RNA at four different time points. And she's looking at gene expression at different time points in the resistant 410353 versus susceptible Raleigh. And the idea is to look at gene expression and focus specifically on those QTL regions, those major QTL regions, to see what might be the causal genes for resistance in this PI. So it's kind of a neat story, you know, because we went from actually germplasm characterization in terms of diversity, finding pools of diversity that we're interested in, screening those for traits of interest, identifying a resistant one, developing the markers initially, then doing GBS, identifying the QTL, and now we're kind of like, you know, towards the hopefully, end in a way, not end because it never ends, of the project, trying to identify what are the causal genes. And then, of course, in terms of breeding, what I'm interested in is developing a marker system where we can do marker-assisted selection and continue improving levels of resistance to gray leaf spot in breeding populations by using markers so that we can be more efficient. I have to say that there's multiple other areas that we have applied, you know, this kind of like same process in freeze tolerance being one that have been working since day one. This was part of Jenny Kimball's PhD thesis, then Sidney Graham's master's thesis, and now Susmita Garre is continuing that work. Rocio van der Laat is working on change drug tolerance, screening germplasm. We have found some accessions that are resistant to change drugs and have developed mapping populations. So that's, you know, QTL mapping is the next step. And then Dr. Xinguang Yu has been working on drought tolerance on St. Augustine grass, and Greta Rockstedt now is working on continuing that work, validating QTL, and also doing high throughput phenotyping. I won't have time to talk about all these, but I just wanted to mention this is going on. And then in soja grass breeding, soja grass is kind of like a really interesting warm season grass. It has a lot of potential that hasn't been fully utilized yet. And the reason for that is that while it is a warm season grass and it's grown across the South, it has one of the best cold tolerance among warm season grasses. And actually the area of adaptation, the area of adaptation of the soja grass is a lot further north, and it can actually be grown kind of like on the southern edge of where cool season grasses are grown. And actually, as we improve freeze tolerance in soja grass, that actually is, that area of adaptation is, you know, continuously being pushed further north, which is exciting because, you know, it's kind of like the best of both worlds, right? You have the drought tolerance of a warm season grass with almost the cold tolerance of a cool season grass. And it is a lower input grass than cool season grasses. So very, very interesting species. In terms of taxonomy, the genus Soja contains 11 species. The ones of most commercial importance are Soja japonica, which is coarse texture, as you can see here. And then Soja matrella, which is a finer texture when compared to japonica. There's other species that have been used in breeding. In Australia, actually, Soja macrantha now is being used as a turf, you know, by itself, not as a hybrid. And I think there's a couple of cultivars of macrantha that actually are being introduced into the US. Soja is a tetraploid, the base chromosome number is 20. And the interesting thing about soja grass is that all these species are interfertile. There's no hybridization theory. So interspecific hybridization is a very common method used in breeding. And when you look at most commercial cultivars of soja grass are probably interspecific hybrids between Japonica and Matrella or one of these other species that I mentioned. Soja grass genetic status in 2009, because of these, you know, like wide levels of interspecific hybridization between species, the exact species classification for many of the cultivars and germplasm collections was kind of unclear. Also, you know, soja grasses are originally from Asia, and they were introduced into the US by a collection trip. And then from that collection trip, there's like different germplasm collections that were kind of split and shared. And it's not really well understood, or it was back then, the relationship among private and public collections. The microbes available, I mean, soja grass, we were still using AFLPs back then. There was an important group, research group in Japan that had developed SSRs and had developed some linkage maps and was doing QTL mapping, but it was still kind of like just getting started back in 2009. And there was room for a lot of molecular tools to be developed. So we started, you know, again, at the beginning, trying to understand what was the germplasm that we had. And we acquired access to two different germplasm collections to material transfer agreements. And because of this confusion about how germplasm collections were related to each other, it was very important for us to understand, okay, how many duplicates do we have in our two different collections? How different are these, the one from the other? Like, what are the exact pools of germplasm that we might be interested in looking at more closely, kind of how we did it in St. Augustine grass. So this was part of Jenny Kimball's master's thesis, where she initially she did it with FLPs and then move on to SSRs, look at these germplasm collections, trying to understand, you know, kind of like what was what. And this was actually really interesting work in soja grass because she was able to demonstrate that the level of interspecific hybridization between Matrella and Japonica was actually way more extended than initially thought. And there were a lot of cultivars that were being, you know, commercialized as, okay, this is a Japonica, or okay, this is a Matrella, when in reality they were interspecific hybrids. So you know, like once you kind of like classify things in the right category, then the overlap between Japonica and Nutrella was not as wide as originally thought. So in terms of breeding, there was a lot more breeding being done in soja grass. There were different programs, University of Georgia, University of Florida, Texas A&M University had large germplasm collections they were working in with. There were more than about 50 cultivars that have been released, so way more than San Augustine grass, multiple programs working on soja grasses. There's even private programs working on soja grass. And a lot of focus, of course, was turf quality, right? Like very nice grasses. Some of the most successful cultivars, I listed three there, but I could probably go with 10. So, I mean, my point here, there was a lot more in breeding being done with soja grass than San Augustine grass. Main traits for improvement, aggressiveness is a big one in soja grass. It's a great grass, but one of the Achilles heel is probably how long it takes to establish. It's a slow moving grass. Freeze tolerance is good, but if we want to keep pushing it up, you know, if we want to keep expanding the area of adaptation, it definitely needs to be further expanded. And then in terms of pest resistance, large patch is a big one. You can see in the picture down here, you know, it's a devastating disease in soja grass. It can kill entire areas very quickly, and it takes a while for this to recover. And then nematodes are also one of the major pests in soja grass. I'm not going to talk about specific project, how I did in San Augustine grass, but I do want to mention that we've been done quite a bit of work from the beginning in freeze tolerance, QTL mapping, RNA-seq, proteomics. We're working currently on gene validation. This is kind of like the line of people working on it. Makemi Pruitt started working on QTL mapping as part of her master's thesis. Jess Brown continued that work, looking at controlled freeze, QTL for control freeze resistance. Dr. Xinguan Wu has overseen all this project all this time, and now Carolina Escalona is gonna be continuing this work. And then large patch resistance, we started working on this again with an initial germplasm screen, identifying a line that was resistant. Now Curtis Houghton is working on mapping QTL for resistant as part of his master's thesis. So rather than talking about genomics, I figured for soja grass, I would talk about something completely different, which is kind of the work that we have done in breeding soja grasses for low input, for very, very low input settings. And part of this is a project that started with the Department of Transportation, actually looking at soja grasses for highways, for roadsides across North Carolina. The rationale here is that the Department of Transportation maintains thousands of miles with grasses, different species of grasses, according to the area of North Carolina that they're working on. And maintaining these areas takes a lot of, you know, takes a big chunk of their budget. Both in terms of controlling weeds in these areas and also maintaining these areas mowed. And, you know, this is important to increase visibility. It's not just beautification of roadsides, but it's also a safety concern. It's a huge safety concern to have areas that are not just overgrown with weeds. So they were interested in looking at soja grass as a possible species to, you know, manage weed control and reducing mowing. And ultimately, all this together means reducing cost of maintenance. But it's not just cost, safety is a big thing for them. It's not just how much money we're putting into the budget. It's about getting people off the roadsides, having to mow and maintain these areas. So the project started as just looking at aggressive soja grasses. It was kind of like a dream project in that, you know, very rarely as a breeder, somebody tells you, I want you to breed for just one trait. They were interested in aggressiveness more than anything. And of course, the idea is that with roadsides, how fast they establish, how well they outcompete weeds, and how well they can survive with zero inputs, right? Just rainfall. Is way more important than how beautiful the grass looks to you, because at 60 miles per hour or 50 miles per hour, you cannot really look at turf quality. So we selected some aggressive lines out of nurseries. We established a pilot study on a roadside looking at how well they establish. And based on the success of that study, we actually moved that to larger trials on roadsides both on the east and west part of the state. So this is data from both sides of the state from 2018, and we had these, we analyzed five different lines, and we had this one line, 14069, that was pretty aggressive and established in both in the east and the west side. This is what that trial looked like when we first established it. This is in July. This is when we come back in August, and you can see here, you know, this picture is a really good depiction on how drastic it is when we're talking about weed control. This is how crazy those roadsides can get. And of course, chemical management, you know, implies costs. And this is what the plot looks like when you mow it. And this is what it looked like by the end of year two. So the idea is to have a species that that can outcompete weeds, and that ultimately, even if it takes 2 years, it will establish into turf and it will reduce the management requirements for that roadside. Now here we had to mow because if we're gonna evaluate coverage, of course you need to see where you're evaluating. So that was the catch of these. You can see here a compilation of the data from both. Lenoir County is on the east side of the state, and Yadkin County is on the west side of the state. So we're kind of looking at different climates for these 2018-2019 data. TPI is the Turf Performance Index, which is how many times a line appear in the top group of significance. And you can see here that this line 14069 is doing extremely well as one of the checks. And, you know, it's performing very well for all traits evaluated across dates of evaluation. Around the same time, we started a project in collaboration with Purdue University and the University of Georgia, looking at soja grasses for golf course roughs. The idea, again, low input, right? You're looking at roughs are kind of like the largest areas in a golf course. They have to be maintained. And they were interested at looking at a grass that could perform well under low inputs. And they were interested in soja grasses, not just for the southeast, but also for different climates. So we started these trials, which we grew in five different locations across the United States. So we looked at Indiana as kind of like the, you know, the cold climate, and then North Carolina and Georgia were warm and humid climates. But then we went out west because we were very interested in seeing how soja grasses would perform under the warm, arid climates in Arizona and California. This is what the trials look in California and Arizona. And you can see this is not the most beautiful looking grass, I know, but these were grown under very low inputs. Basically the Escondido trial had no additional irrigation. It was just rainfall and almost no mowing. I think they were mowed once in the whole year. And then the Arizona trial, of course, you know, that's a completely arid environment, not much rain. So it had to be irrigated, but it had minimal irrigation. So in this case, you're not looking at, you know, what is the most beautiful looking plot. You're looking at how well does a plot retain color and survives under these conditions. And you can see that there's some, you know, dramatic differences among these genotypes and how well they're surviving and how green they look. So looking at the data across the years of evaluation and across environments, this is Indiana, North Carolina, Georgia, Arizona, California, this line 14069 was actually the top performing line in terms of turf performance index, right? Like how many times it was in the top significant group across locations, across traits, across years of evaluation. So we were pretty happy to see that, you know, not only it was doing very well, but the most exciting thing was that it was performing well across these very different climates. Around the same time, in 2018, the National Turfgrass Evaluation Program started a new trial looking at low input grasses. So this was actually different species, Bermuda grass, buffalo grass, soja grass, and I believe there were some seed mixes also. And you can see that this trial was planted in a lot of different locations, but also very diverse locations. And the big thing with these low input trial or program was that at most of these locations, irrigation was minimal. It was either just minimal to prevent dormancy or only during severe stress. So minimal irrigation. And this is kind of like a summary table of the 2020 data. This is from last year, and you can see here at the top is across locations. And once again, 14069 is the top line in terms of turf performance index. Again, how many times is in the top group of significance across traits, across dates also and locations. So very excited about how this line has done in terms of low inputs. And actually this year we commercially released this line. The beauty of working with a vegetatively propagated species is that when you wanna propagate enough material to grow an acre to go in a foundation field, that is 600 trays of plugs. And you can see it's basically our little wall of turf grass, which is pretty cool. So this actually is being grown in three different foundation fields, 2.5 acres total. And it should kind of hit the market next year. So the program, you know, we started with very little, but this is what it looks like right now. We work on four different warm season grasses. I didn't get to talk about everything or all species. There's no time for that. But I figured I would kind of give you this like one shot of what the program looks like these days. In all these five species, we work on conventional breeding, focusing in abiotic stress tolerance and also some specific diseases and insect in some cases. We do genomics work mostly in soja grass and San Augustine grass. And then we also play a little bit. The beauty of working with a non-food crop is that you can sometimes, you know, play around with some crazy projects. We do some tissue culture, mutation breeding. We do quite a bit of polyploidy breeding in the case of San Augustine grass. And ultimately, you know, the big goal of the program is to release cultivars that are gonna go be grown across the state and across the southern US. And also a secondary product of the program that we don't think about that often is graduate education. You know, some of these projects serve as platforms for training of grad students. So the program is what it is because of the amazing people that work in it. These are the current members of the breeding program. You have seen pictures of most of them, I believe. I think I miss Esdras Carvajal, who probably is upset with me because I didn't show any of his projects. Esdras works in shade tolerance in Bermuda grass. He does a lot of the interpolyp crossing in San Augustine grass. So I'm sorry, Esdras, I didn't show your projects, but he's a very integral part of the program. And then of course, there's all the people that have been through the program in all these years. I know this slide is not inclusive. I know that I'm forgetting some people, but I figure I'll give you some representation of the main players. And then also, of course, there's all the collaborators that work with us in all these projects. I would say, and I'm a firm believer, and I say it over and over, no breeding program is an island. I think one of the things that I love the most about breeding is how interdisciplinary it is. I need to start by acknowledging my collaborators here at NC State. First and foremost is Dr. Grady Miller, who's our turf management specialist. A lot of the projects that I have shown today are worked in collaboration with him. And then I'll also say that, you know, although I talked a lot about niches and where we would fit, a lot of these projects are in collaboration with some of the other breeders in the Southeast. It's an excellent group to work with. We collaborate on a lot of projects, and some of those guys actually are personal friends of mine. None of our work would be possible without the research stations. We work at three different research stations in North Carolina, and those guys do an excellent job at maintaining our plots and working with us in, you know, like adjusting things and growing crazy things. And then we have very diverse sources of funding from the very little to the very big, and we appreciate all of it. I especially want to give a shout out to the North Carolina Salt Producers Association. We work in collaboration very closely with farmers who help us, you know, like think about what traits are important, and also help us test some of these lines in the last stages of testing before commercial release. I am always amazed at the generosity of farmers in growing our lines and giving us not only land to plant some of our nurseries and trials, but also growing these themselves and managing them themselves and give us, you know, input on what they think about these lines. So that's it for me. I will close with this quote. Earl Wernsman was a member of my master's committee, and he always said that plant breeding comes in 30 easy lessons, one lesson per year. And I find that that is absolutely true. Every year we learn something new, and you know, it's almost like you only have so many seasons in your breeding program. And every time you make a mistake, you think about how you just lost 1 year. So I'll stop there, and I thank you for your attendance, and I'll be happy to take questions.
Thank you so much, Susana. Very, very well done, and great presentation. I think there's a lot of graduate students in the audience, and I think it's going to benefit greatly. We already have a few questions. Well, I have one question in the chat. Again, you guys can post your questions in the QA window or in the chat, and we will I will relay them to Susana. There's a question here from Jules, is why these days people are so interested in artificial turf for playing fields?
That's a really good question. So I think when they, so I remember, you know, like maybe 10 years ago when I started the breeding program, artificial turf started making a lot of noise. And I remember somebody gave a presentation at our annual society meetings showing the cost involved with maintaining an artificial field versus a natural field. And I think that the artificial companies made a lot of noise saying, oh, you don't have to maintain these. This is gonna be so much easier. Think about your players, you know, like you can play all you want and you're not gonna have to replace grass or monkey with maintenance and all that. And in reality, the cost of maintaining an artificial turf is not cheaper. And an artificial field is not cheaper than natural grass. I think, you know, like people jump into it not fully knowing how much maintenance has to go into artificial turf. There's also some information on like injury to athletes, you know, so like, yeah, they can practice more often, but it's not as forgiving as natural grass. So, you know, like to summarize the answer, I think because there's misinformation on how much it takes to maintain artificial grass. It's not as easy as people think it is.
Okay. We have a question on the Q&A from Jim Holland. Are the QTL effects for gray leaf spot resistant big enough for molecular assisted breeding selection to be efficient?
Yes.
Okay. And are the markers tightly linked enough to maintain the linkage through the breeding cycles?
So I didn't show like the full table without the QTL because of time, but some of these are major. We're explaining like 25% of the variation or something like that. So it's worth going after them. We have started developing the markers, but we're not there yet. We haven't started using marker assisted selection yet. In a way, we kind of have waited. I mean, like I think when Ashley has results on, you know, more specific genes, then we'll jump on having diagnostic markers and starting to screen these.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Question from Rahul Kumar. What is the scope for gene editing in turfgrass breeding?
Oh, that's a good question.
And are you doing anything?
You know, some of the issue here, at least for warm season grasses, is transformation. Some of these are more amenable to transformation than others. Some of them are just not amenable at all to transformation, like Bermuda grass is one example of that. I don't know. I know people that worked on genetic modification of grass, like, you know, transgenesis, the old fashioned way. I don't know anybody who's working on gene editing right now, but that might be just my ignorance. You know, I might be ignorant of what's going on. I'm not saying that just because I don't know doesn't mean that it's not happening. I'm just saying it's not that widespread.
Right, okay. A question from Elizabeth Strally. Thanking you for the presentation is saying, have you looked at mixing different varieties? What will be the influence on different traits, for example, disease resistance? She said, as I'm assuming monoculture is a big problem from growing and maintaining turf grasses.
That's almost a planted question. I swear I didn't. I enjoy that question because we actually have a project. Adam Dale, who's the entomologist at University of Florida, has a USDA funded project looking at mixes of St. Augustine grass to see what are the effects on both beneficial insects and pests. He has some really interesting you know, very promising data that cultivar mixes actually have better disease, pest insect resistance, excuse me, than monocultures. So we're looking at, you know, like monoculture mixes of two cultivars, mixes of four cultivars, looking at what we see, and we're collecting insects and seeing, you know, counting how many beneficials versus how many pests, and then rating the plots. And the data looks like, you know, I mean, duh, I guess, right? Like mixes are much better. But the big question on that is, how do we implement that at the salt farm level? Because also one of the things that we're looking at is, we're actually doing molecular we're using SSR markers to track that the cultivar mixes actually remain mixes through time, right? And after year one, we're already seeing big changes where one genotype might be more aggressive and it's kind of like taking over. So where you thought, you know, you had like 25% of each of four cultivars, and then a year later, you actually have like 60% of one, 20% of one, 10 and zero. And we're actually taking more samples this year. Rocio van der Laat is actually doing that research in my lab to see, okay, how has this changed a year later? And if you have a culture that is just taking over, ultimately you're gonna lose the benefits of the mixes. So we'll see where it goes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. There's a comment here in the chat that the perception of artificial fields being easy seems to be misleading, that natural grass is safer and improves environment, data supported and better communicated information is required by all supporters of beautiful, sustainable natural grass. Okay, so you have a supporter there for your program, Susana. I did share your email address there. Somebody asked for your email address in the chat. We don't have any open questions in the Q&A. Please, we have time to answer a few more questions. There's another one that came here in the Q&A. Can dwarf turf grass cultivars play an important role in the low input turf grass breeding?
It depends what species you're talking about. The thing with dwarf grasses, so we work with some dwarf genotypes in St. Augustine grass, for example. And the problem is, you know, as these are vegetatively propagated grasses, establishment is a key trait for production, right? Like there's one thing with me in my breeding program, establishing a plot and waiting for it to grow. A salt grower makes a living depending on how many harvests he gets in a year, right? So like we had this one dwarf accession in the breeding program that was beautiful and we loved it. And we were so convinced that this was gonna do something, right? And then we planted it in a salt farm in a larger plot and we realized, okay, commercially, this is never gonna make it. So they're interested in terms of using them as parents for crosses in terms of turf quality. But then on the commercial side of things, it gets a lot more tricky.
Okay. A question from Gabriel de Sequeira. Thanking you for the presentation. His question is if you think that the species you're working with could benefit from an integrated mapping approach, especially the polyploid ones.
What do you mean by integrated mapping approach?
I don't know, Gabriel. I don't know if he's thinking about social grass and having different species and having an integrated molecular maps. I don't know. I'll wait, Gabriel, if you can explain your question a bit more, okay? Follow-up question for Jules, question about artificial grass. What is the benefit for breeders investing in turf grass if maintenance on field is a concern?
So, turf grasses are one of those species where maintenance is very, very key, right? Like turf maintenance is a huge area of an academic area, and there's multiple people working on that. There, depending on what type of fields you're talking about, there's huge amounts of maintenance that goes into them. Like for example, you know, like soccer fields, Barcelona, for the football, the real football aficionados in the crowd, the amount of maintenance that go into the grass is absolutely unbelievable. And there's fields that actually have like cooling pads and heating pads under the grass. And there's additional light that goes into it. But those are for the very highly manicured grasses that need to look good, not just in person, but on TV. Plus, they get a lot of play on them. So wear is a huge issue, right? And if you're gonna play Saturday and you're gonna play next Wednesday, that becomes a very huge issue. So that, you know, those grasses, maintenance is gonna play a key role, more important than breeding in a sense, no matter what, right? But that's a sector, that's a small sector of the industry. The low input grasses are more important for landscapes, homeowners, roadsides, churches, schools, you know, which again, they spend less money on those grasses, but by the time you add up all those areas, it's a huge sector and maybe more important sector of the industry.
I'm gonna take advantage of your comments. My question I wrote down here for myself is, have you explored the role of allelopathy and in terms of low inputs for preventing weeds?
No.
Growth? No.
We have not.
We have that work here in, with rye going on with Paul and Ramon working on that. So.
Yeah, I know. Chris works on that. He had a project with Paul going on that. We have not worked on that. One of the reasons why soja grass, for example, is such an interesting species is because it's very dense. So it chokes out weeds. You know, it might be slow to establish. So it's very slow to grow. And because of that, you get weeds, you know, like at the beginning. But over time, when it fully establishes, it's such a dense turf that it outcompetes really weeds really well. And that's what makes it a desirable species.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Gabriel elaborated a bit more on his question. He said, I meant instead of having two maps, one for each parents have an integrated map.
Yeah, we do that too, where we do separate maps for each parent and then integrated them into one. Yes.
Okay. Well, thank you, Susana. Thank you so much for an excellent seminar. I'm sharing my screen now. Thank you so much for everybody that attended this seminar. The recording is going to be available pretty soon. And it's going to be for the last seminar announcement. It's going to be right there, the link to the recording. Thank you, Brandon, for all your help. And Anthony also for the support that you guys provided. Next week is the last seminar of the series. And we're going to have a representative from the seed industry, Vincent Asiago, who is the head of R&D for HM Claus, talking about strategic portfolio management and innovation for a global vegetable seed company. I think it's going to be a very interesting seminar also, and I look forward to seeing you in the attendance. Thank you so much, Susana.
Thanks, Carlos. I enjoyed it.
All right. Okay. You guys have a nice rest of the week. Okay. Bye.
Bye.